أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين الصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن استنى بسنته إلى يوم الدين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته Alhamdulillah, we start by praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and we send our salam and salawat on Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Alhamdulillah, we started a series of the biographies of the famous four Imams, and in this journey we have already finished the biography of Imam Abu Hanifa and also Imam Malik. Last week we finished the life story of Imam Malik. So obviously, inshallah, we're going to the third great Imam of Imam Shafeyii today, inshallah ta'ala. So today's in short talk, we'll just start the conversation about Imam Shafeyii. We'll talk about his birth and, you know, his lineage and some of the qualities that he had from the very early childhood. And inshallah ta'ala, slowly we'll go into his travel, his ilm, and his other qualities and his political aspect, inshallah ta'ala. So let's begin. So as an introduction, as you all know that Imam Shafi, his lineage was the highest and you can say the richest lineage of all the four Imam. He was known, just like Imam Malik was known, as the Imam of Medina. So his title was Imam of Medina because all his life is spent in Medina. He's dedicated his life for the people of Medina and teach them, you know, the knowledge. For Imam Shafi, he was called the Imam of Quraysh. The Imam of Quraysh, because he was linked, you know, very, very closely with the lineage of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So his name was, you know, Muhammad ibn Abu Idris, okay, Ash-Shafi. Muhammad ibn Abu Idris Ash-Shafi. So his father name was Idris. Basically, his grandfather was, his name was, you know, Sa'ib ibn Ubaid, and he was a Sahaba. And he accepted Islam very early on, just after, actually on the day of Badr. So on the day of Badr, his grandfather was fighting against Muslim, and then obviously the Muslim win the battle, as you all know, and they had few people POW, like, you know, the prisoner of war. And one of the prisoner of war was the grandfather of Imam Shafi. And once he ransomed himself, as the people ransomed with their knowledge. So, and people who had the writing ability and reading ability, and then he ransomed himself, and he was amazed by the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he accepted Islam on the day of Battle of Badr. So later on, this Sahabi, we don't know much about him, but, you know, he was with a Muslim. But later on, during the time of Abu Bakr, or maybe till the time of Umar, he left Makkah, Medina, and went to the Palestine in Gaza area. You know, the recent Gaza area, that's where he was there, and on a business trip basically. And he actually connected, actually this guy Sa'ib ibn Ubaid, he was connected with Hashimi tribe. Basically, he's from a Hashimi tribe, and which is also actually linked with the tribe of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. His close tribe was, you know, Banu Muttalib. You know, Banu Muttalib was the sister tribe of Hashimi tribe, so they all come from the same lineage, you know, Abd Manaf, you know, if you go great grandfather of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So when he went to Gaza and he had a family there, so he had a son called Idris there, and Idris got married there. And when Idris got married, meaning the mother of Imam Shafi, she is also a great granddaughter of Hassan ibn Ali ibn Abi Talib. So Hassan, the son of Ali, has a granddaughter, and she has a granddaughter. So that's great granddaughter of you know, and she is the mother of Imam Shafi. So as you can see, from both sides, from father and mother's side, Imam Shafi was connected with the lineage of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Imam Shafi, he was born in the Hijri 150 Hijri. So after the 150 Hijri, he was born, and that is the same year that Imam Abu Hanifa passed away. Okay, and some of the narration actually say that some of the authentic narration by other scholars later say the day Imam Abu Hanifa was passed away, the same day was Imam Shafi was born. You know, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took one from the Ummah and he gave another one. Okay, So, and he was born in Gaza, as I said, but very early on, he was being moved, his mother, because he lost his father when he was only 1 or 1.5 years old. So he couldn't remember anything about his father, basically, because his father was sick and he passed away. And his mother didn't get remarried, although she was very young at that time, but his mother didn't get remarried. And she decided that, you know, I'm going to take my son and go back to Makkah. Go back to Makkah because that is the place, that is the haram, and, you know, I want to focus on my son. And later on, actually, Imam Shafeyii said in his books and in other things that, you know, my mom told me that just because of you, I am not getting married. It is very unusual for that time for a lady to survive by herself as a single mom or as a widow, actually. It is very difficult. But she said, no, I want to focus on my son, on his study, and, you know, I don't want to get remarried because I don't know the man who will come into my life, how will be with my son. So she very early on, she saw something in her son, and that she understood, no, it is all sacrificing my own life, but, you know, I will concentrate on my son. And as Imam Ahmed, you know, Imam Ahmed was a student of Imam Shafi'i. So Imam Shafi'i, he has a teacher who is Imam Malik. So Imam Shafi'i, you can say the first teacher, you can say, official first teacher, Imam Malik. And Imam Ahmed is his student. So he is like in the middle. So he is a student of a great Imam, and he has a great student who is the Imam. Okay? And that's why, you know, Imam Ahmed said in one of the comments that, you know, Prophet Muhammad SAW said that every 100 years, Prophet SAW said in the hadith, in the authentic hadith, that every 100 years, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will send someone who will revive the Ummah, who will bring good things back to Ummah, will try his best to bring the Ummah in the right position. And those are the called Mujaddid. These are the people called Mujaddid. And according to all this, it's like unanimous opinion of all the people that the first Mujaddid, the first person come after the 100 years was, you know, it was the Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, the great grandson of Umar ibn Khattab, Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, because before him, lot of Umayyad, you know, Khilafah, they were like, you know, they're just after the power and money and politics, but he came and he tried to bring the Ummah in the right position, but unfortunately he only lived for his Khilafah, you know, 2.5 years, and then he passed away. The second Mujaddid, the second 100 year, because he was born in 150 Hijra, there's no doubt about it, that everybody said this is no other than Imam Shafi'i. People used to say, because Imam Ahmed, they used to say, like, I think you are the Mujaddid, because, you know, he was a student of Imam Shafi'i. And Imam Ahmed, when you go and talk about his life, he was also a great Imam, you know, and he fight for the Ummah in a lot of issues we'll talk about, inshallah ta'ala. But he himself said, no, wallahi, I'm not the Mujaddid, it is no one but Imam Shafi'i. So he was a genius from the very, very early childhood. And the things that you're going to hear, few of the things that I will mention, it will blow your mind away. I mean, this is a miracle child, basically. So when he was only 1 and 2 years old, his mom brought him to Makkah and tell him that, you know, try to go, when he's like 3, 4 years old, try to go and, you know, learn from the people, learn from the halakha. But when her mom, because her mom being is, you know, widow, and she doesn't have no one to take care, you know, and she's a lady, she was, her state was very, very poor. They are a very poor family, you know, and his clothes and, you know, wearing, everything was poor. Imam Shafi'i mentioned one of them, when we came to Makkah, we didn't know what we're going to have tonight. And sometimes we have, me and my mother had one date and we split up, I had half, my mom had half. And sometimes we used to wait that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send us food with someone. Sometimes they had a glass of milk for the whole night. And I split up and my mom split up. So, you know, their situation was really, really poor at that time. But still, her mom focusing on her, on him, on study, and, you know, getting ilm from the knowledge. And at the age of only 6 or 7 years old, he memorized the whole Quran. And just by listening to the people of recitation of other people. He didn't have a proper mushaf at that time. Like a proper, because that time people used to go and, because at that time, and 150 Hijra, this is talking about 160, 157 Hijra, so he's like 7 years old, okay? In that time, you know, paper is not available. It's like there are parchment and other things like this. So it is very hard to get a book. And if you get a book from someone, you know, because there are already book been written by Imam Malik, you know, Imam Malik's Muwatta is already there. Other scholars have written other books, other collection of hadith was also there. But it is very hard to get a book, it's expensive, and also you have to copy it, you need ink and everything. Ink has a price at that time, so it was very expensive. So he just listened to the people, he went to the haram, he listened to the people's halakat, and somehow he memorized the whole Quran. Then after the, he memorizing the whole Quran at 7 years old, you know, he went to learn something new. And he asked people, what should I learn next? So people say, there's a book called Muwatta. As you know, the Muwatta is a book of Imam Malik. And it was a bigger book than Quran, because this is hadith and explanation of all the fiqh. Hadith and, you know, and different logic, or as I mentioned in before that, you know, in Muwatta, Imam Malik put all the hadiths there, you know, depending to every fiqh issue, and he tried to explain that. So at the age of 9, he memorized the Muwatta. Imagine. And this is a bigger book than Quran. Quran is, because for Arab people, it's easy to memorize because it's rhythmic, you know, and a lot of words are the same. If you want to see it there, maybe it is possible. You know, we have still people, still young child, you know, in 7 years, 8 years old, they are like half it, you know, you can find it still now. But, you know, memorizing a whole book of Muwatta, it is very, very difficult. And when he used to read and, you know, revise his Quran, he used to always cover one page. Because he said, if I look at the two pages together, I memorize them across. So his memory was like completely photographic memory. He doesn't have to read. He look at the things and he used to memorize it. So that's why he used to cover one page, because he know this page comes first. So he memorized this and then he's good. Otherwise, he can memorize this one, even from the other side also. Because if you look at the other way. So that was his memory. And then slowly, the people of the Makkah, you know, they understood that this child has something very, very, you know, interesting in him. So he went in a halaqah and he sit down with the teacher, but the teacher didn't give his much attention, because the other students were wearing good clothes and everything, because that time already the ummah has a lot of money coming, you know, 150 hijra, you know, the money is everywhere. It's you're in the haram, you know, they're the best, you know, imam of that time. So he's not been noticed, okay? So he came back to his mother and he said, oh mother, I don't want to go to the teachers anymore. I'll learn by myself, because, you know, nobody put attention to me. And his mother said, no, when you go, forget about who gives you attention. You concentrate on what you are listening and try to learn this one. So he went back again to the teacher. And when the teacher used to take break, you know, during the day in the madrasa, he used to go to the other students and ask them, what did you learn today? Like, you know, they say, okay, we learned this page and this page. He just looked at the page and he memorized it. And he used to help the students. So slowly, slowly, this went to the teachers, you know, here. You know, this student is, you know, working and he's helping student and he has this kind of memory. So that teacher made him, you know, his teaching assistant. And slowly and slowly, but not surely, you know, in age of 15 years old, maybe 15 or 16, he became a mufti, almost like a mufti in Makkah. He's a very, very young child. And his appearance, Imam Shafi always had an appearance of baby face. Like, you know, some people have always looked like young. Like, you know, Chinese people look very young all the time, you know. You can't tell their age. And Imam Shafi, all his life, he has only few, he didn't have beard also. Like all other sheikh, like Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik, they have very, very long beard. Because he has such a baby face, even in matured age, he has very, very, very few beard basically coming out from his face, you know, very little beard. But this is, you know, his appearance was like this. So people used to ask him about his age, how old are you? And when he used to get upset about that, because he said, no, when you try to learn something, don't ask the age and don't even say the age. Why? Because if you have in your majalis older people and if you're too young, they will say, oh, this guy is too young, you know, what are you going to learn from him? Or if you're too, you know, old, the young people will say, oh, no, he's from the old time, you know. So that's why it's better not to say the age. So one day what happened actually in the haram, you know, in Makkah, during the Ramadan, he was doing a class of the fiqh of Ramadan, okay? And it's like during the daytime, so everybody fasting. So when he's doing the halaqah, he took a glass of water and he sipped it. And everybody's looking, you know, he's doing a fiqh of Ramadan, in Ramadan, and he's not fasting, how can he's drinking water? So they ask him, why are you drinking water? He said, no, I haven't reached my puberty. So, you know, Ramadan is not fard on me yet, and it's too hot. You know, I have to teach you guys, so, you know, I need to drink water. So he hasn't reached his puberty, but he's a teacher in the haram of the people. Imagine, like, you know, and people were amazed to see that, you know. So he was like this one. Then, at the age of 17 or 18, some people say and told him, like one of the scholars of that time, he said, Bunayya, meaning, oh my boy, you know, you have lots of knowledge, Allah has put something special in you, you should now concentrate on learning fiqh. So he said, I already memorized the Muwattab, the book of Muwattab, because that is the famous book at that time. He said, no, it is not only from the book, you should go to the teacher and learn from him. So at that time, his mother also heard this, and his mother, you know, sold everything that she had in her possession, and he said, okay, let's leave Makkah and go to Medina to teach from the great Sheikh Imam Malik. Now, before she went, because she was so much, focusing on her son, she said it is very hard to get into the halakha to become a student of Imam Malik. And we mentioned this before, it's like at the Harvard or Oxford of that time, So what she did, she asked the Mufti of Makkah to get a letter from the governor of Makkah to the governor of Medina, saying that, this son has some special quality, like a recommendation letter, as we have. So they wrote a recommendation letter and to the Medina, governor of Medina, and asking of the governor of Medina to write a letter to Imam Malik so that he accepts. But as you all know from the life story of Imam Malik, he never used to like the political people. And this is the end of Imam Malik's life. Imam Malik will live another 6 years. So Imam Malik will have time as a student of Imam Shafi only 6 years. So last 6 years of Imam Malik's time. So he's already very old, and he has went through this political thing. So he had a bitterness towards the political people. So when Imam Shafi came with the letter, he just crumpled it and threw it. He said, no, I don't like this recommendation. And he didn't accept him. But then Imam Shafi came back and he said, oh my teacher, listen to me, I already memorized the Quran and I already memorized the, your book Muwatta, so listen to me as I said. By the time, by this time he was almost 23 years old. So he was 23 years old when he is in Medina. And he also, after he learned the Muwatta and Quran, what he did, he went to, when he was in Makkah, he went to a tribe called Hudayl. And we mentioned this tribe when we explain, say the life story of Abdul ibn Mas'ud. The Hudayl tribe has the most authentic Arabic dialect, okay? Their poetry, their poems were very, very heavy and, very rich, in content in their language. So he spent a lot of time with that tribe. And his Arabic became so eloquent. When you hear his Arabic, his recitation, people are mesmerized, okay? And when he started saying Muwatta to Imam Malik, Imam Malik heard that and he understood there's something inside this boy. He now understand. And then he said, okay, read more for me. So he keep reading the Muwatta. Because his Arabic was so nice, even his own book, Imam Malik was enjoying it because it is coming from his mouth because of his Arabic, the way he is pronouncing the Arabic. And then slowly Imam Malik said, okay, come tomorrow, because I think I saw something inside you, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put something light in you, and it's ill, and make sure you always obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because once you are disobedient in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah will take this light away. Because ilm is nothing but a light from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he accepted his idea and he became a student of Imam Malik. And as I mentioned, he was with him and he went to no other teacher until Imam Malik passed away. So 6 years he spent with Imam Malik, and most of the time, he had agreed on all the matters of Imam Malik. Sometimes there are a few issues that he has disagreement, but with that also he showed his uttermost humility. That he never used to say something in front of Imam Malik. He used to say like outside, and that is to come to Imam Malik's ear. He did some disagreement with that. For example, one of the guy came with a talaq matter. So at that time people had all these weird things about talaq. We told before that Harun al-Rashid, one of the Khalifa, he said, I give you, you'll be talaq from tonight if you cannot leave my kingdom in one night. We told this story. When you talked about Imam Abu Hanifa, Imam Malik. So same thing, one guy came and he said, he was joking with his wife, and he said to his wife, if you're not beautiful than a moon, if you're not beautiful than moon, then you are talaq. Okay, so it's very difficult to be more beautiful than the moon. And the guy understood that he made a mistake, and he came to Imam Malik. Imam Shafi was sitting there. He said, what I'm going to do? I said it because I'm joking, and I was, in a good mood. I would have a loving chat, but I just said it. Imam Malik said, no, look, if you say it, you repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it will count as one divorce. So make sure you take her back after the proper timing. So guy, that person felt very, very sad because he has no intention to do it, okay? But he did it, okay? So he left and he was going, so Imam Shafi followed him, okay? And he told him, no, you are not divorced. So this guy said, why? How come you say? Because he said, you know, Allah said, لَقَدْ خَلَقْنَا الْإِنسَانَ فِي أَحْسَنِ تَقْوِينَ. Allah has made insan the best creation. So moon cannot be better than your wife. So this is a, he put logic, okay? And which is valid. And the guy feel really, because that's fine, so I'm not divorced. So this thing came to Imam Malik later on, and Imam Malik said, that's fine, he's happy actually that Imam Shafi find a way for this guy, and which is a valid logic, you know. So in this matter, so he has a disagreement on this one. Also, Imam Malik himself also had a knowledge called Firasa. Firasa was a very popular thing at that time, and still we have it, you know. There are people who can see other people's face and they can tell about him, okay. Umar ibn al-Khattab had this knowledge, you know, and other Sahaba also had this knowledge. So Imam Malik had this knowledge a lot. So they can see people's face and tell what kind of trouble he's going through, or what was his profession actually. So one day one guy was walking by, so Imam Malik said, I think this guy is a shepherd. So Imam Shafi said, no, I think he's a carpenter. So they had a disagreement, okay, let's call the guy. So they called the guy and asked, you know, what is your profession? Say, I was a shepherd, now I became a carpenter. I used to be a shepherd, now you were. So both are right, you know. So this was the, you know, his time and, you know, and his knowledge with Imam Malik. So he used to go to his mom, and his mom said, okay, you are spending so much time with Imam Malik, you know, we left Makkah, we came, what did you learn? So he said, oh mom, I learned a lot of knowledge and a lot of adab. Then his mom said, no, then you haven't learned anything, go back. So he said, he's a bit hard, why did my mom tell that way? So he went back to Imam Malik and he said, look, I told my mom that I learned from you ilm and adab, but my mom was not happy. So Imam Malik said, go to your mom and say, you learned adab and ilm. So she went back and he said to his mom, oh mom, I learned adab and ilm. So he put adab, the manners first. And then his mom hugged him and said, no, now you learned something. So imagine, because you know that, you know, Imam Malik was a moral of adab, you know, and his more things was adab. So when he said that, he said, yes, you will learn something. Obviously, the other qualities of Imam Shafi, his fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his humility was great, and he was a great reciter of the Quran. People just used to come to hear his recitation. One of the things that we're going to mention, and we're going to finish it for today, inshallah ta'ala, that once Imam Malik passed away, and he became more popular, okay, and people used to call him for different issues for debate, okay, but he never wanted to do debate. And before but people used to force him that there are issues that you need to do debates and arguments. He never ever lose a single debate in his life, never ever. And people who were against him was like, you know, they were beaten in so bad, like, you know, their logic will never stand in front of the logic of Imam Shafi. But he, before he started the debate, he always used to make dua that, oh Allah, guide the person who is debating with you, and I'm debating just for the sake of you, so that the truth comes out. But in that way, one of the incident happened that one day Imam Shafi went to another scholar, his name was Waqia. So he was a senior scholar at that time, and he was very knowledgeable, and he also had a very good memory of recitation, the Hadith and Quran. So he told Imam Shafi, went to him and said, I can't memorize like I memorized before. I used to memorize a lot, I used to see the pages and I used to memorize. Now I cannot do it, what's happening with me? So he asked, did you do any sin? Then he remembered, yes, I do a sin. I was walking in the path and there was a lady, and my eyes went to her ankle. So the ankles were exposed, the feet of the woman, and I saw that. And I understood this is a sin. Imagine, you know, just looking at an ankle of an woman, and he understood that something happened. It's a disobedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and his memory was getting weaker. So he said, you know, pray more and make istighfar to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you more knowledge. Inshallah ta'ala, we'll stop here. Then we'll talk about his traveling, like how he left Makkah and Medina after that and traveled around the world, and, you know, how he had established his madhab, and we'll go from there. JazakAllahu khairan, subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.